This glazed braised short rib recipe is sponsored by Squarespace, the all-in-one tool to help you glaze and braise your website into existence. Save 10% by using my link and code in the description. The short rib is surely one of the top three most delicious pieces of meat on a cow. I like to braise them until they've gone the texture of jello and then reduce the braising liquid to a sweet, sticky glaze. You'll need a big pot with a lid, and I'm going to preheat this to a moderate heat. Here's about 3.5 pounds of short ribs, English cut. English cut means little rectangles of meat with one long bone in them. This looks like a ton of meat, I realize, but it's really only enough for about 3 or 4 people. I think you want 2 or 3 English cut ribs per person, because much of the mass here is bone that we're going to take out, and fat and connective tissue that we're going to melt out. Certainly make sure that you got at least 2 thick, meaty ones like this per person, because some of the ones you get will be like this. There's hardly any actual meat on that. Teeny little bit of oil in the pan just to get these started. A ton more fat is going to come out of these. I'm going to lay them in and brown them slowly. Moderate heat. No point in seasoning them. They're going to be totally coated in glaze. While that's going, I'll prep some veggies to flavor the braising liquid, just some ratty old carrots and celery from the fridge. It's all getting strained out at the end. Roughly chop up a red onion, and I would specifically recommend red here. It's going to be good for the color. When the ribs are brown on the first side, I'll flip them around, and as they shrink, look at how much exposed surface there is on the pan. Look at how much more there is once I start laying these on their sides to brown the sides. If we were really aggressively searing these, all of that exposed surface would be burning, and that would be a catastrophe. The sauce is everything with this dish, and if you burn the fond at the bottom of the pan, you ruin the sauce. Take your time, brown these slowly. They don't have to be deep brown all over. If you were trying to cook enough for like 8 people, you would want to color them in 2 batches. Pull out the ribs for a sec and then throw in the veggies just to get a little color on them, just a little head start. Don't let anything burn, and here comes a squeeze of tomato paste. That is not going to make the sauce taste tomatoey. It just brings depth and strength of flavor, especially if you stir it around a little bit and let it brown. But now you got to be careful, because that stuff is full of sugar and it'll burn in a flash. Right before it does, I'll deglaze with a whole bottle of cheap, dry white wine. This is the recipe that got me using white wine in everything. I cooked this with red for years because the rules say you always cook beef in red. But I'm reducing this liquid to a glaze at the end, and when you reduce a lot of red wine to a glaze, it's really too intense in my opinion. It goes bitter and harsh. But when you reduce white wine to a glaze, it tastes like candy, and I figure that if I use a red onion in there, you'll still get a purplish liquid at the end that looks nice on beef, if you care about that. If you don't want to use alcohol, I would use about 3 cups of chicken or beef stock, plus maybe a 1/4 cup of balsamic vinegar to start with, probably add more vinegar to taste at the end. For other flavorings, you could throw in whatever spices or dried herbs you want at this stage. I'm going to do a star anise. I really like how that licorice flavor balances the sweetness of the glaze, but this is a polarizing flavor. A lot of people don't like it. If you're not sure if you like it, maybe use a little chunk of one of these, not a whole one. I'm also throwing in some coriander seeds. Those pair nice with a star anise. But like any flavors could go in here. Some smoked dried chilies, some orange peel. Go crazy. White wine is a blank canvas for flavor. I'll start with a big pinch of salt. I'll probably add more salt to the glaze later to taste. Ribs back in, and it doesn't matter that they're not fully submerged. They don't have to be. And if you were doing more here, you could just pile them on top of each other. You could cook these quicker by really boiling them, or by putting this in the oven, or certainly by doing this in a pressure cooker. But I like to get the heat to a bare simmer, then cover and cook these very slowly all day, about 8 hours. If the heat is really low, you can just get it going and forget about it. If you're at home, you can check on them every couple hours, flip them around a little bit, though I don't think that does very much. If you just keep it at a bare simmer, the liquid will not boil out and you won't have to worry about anything burning. The house smells amazing all day, and at the end, you'll have thoroughly braised beef that is still pink on the inside. It's a real magic trick. At some point, the bones will start falling off. That's just fine. You could probably stop cooking at that point, but I really like to cook these to the point where they're like beef butter, which you can tell by just poking at them or maybe give one a little tear. Extremely soft, so be very careful as you start pulling these out to a plate. They are very delicate. A little sieve over a bowl, and I'll strain out the braising liquid, give those solids a good squeeze, and then toss them out. You can see there's a huge layer of fat on top there, and we have to get that out. I often leave the fat in my braising liquids, but we're going to reduce this to a glaze, and glazes do not hold fat inside them. The fat would all just spill out like that, but way, way worse, because by the time we reduce this, there's going to be like 3 times as much fat by volume compared to the glaze. You could take out the fat with a gravy separator, or you could do what I do, which is to to throw some ice cubes in there to cool this down and then throw it in the fridge. I usually do everything you've seen so far the day before. Once the meat has cooled down a little bit, we can clean it up, take the bones out, and each big cube of meat will have a big band of connective tissue on the outside where the bone was. You could eat that, it's soft, but if it grosses you out, you can scrape it off with a butter knife. You could do the same with any really big globs of unrendered fat on the outside, but don't go crazy. Short ribs have a ton of fat marbled through them, and that's part of why they taste so good. All right, pure, ready-to-eat meat there. In a bowl, cover it up, and throw that and the covered braising liquid into the fridge, and good night. This is really good as a dinner party dish because you'll see how little work we have to do on this second day. First thing is to defat the braising liquid. If the fat isn't solid enough to do this, throw the bowl in the freezer for a bit. I really like diluting this with ice cubes the night before, not only because that cools it down, but also because it's easier to lift fat out of a thinner, more watery stock. If it's really thick, it tends to blend in with the fat. I'm switching to a slotted spoon there to fish out the last bits of fat, which I will save for a thing. Liquid goes into my Chrissy Teigen pan. Any wide pan will do, but this one's Chrissy's. Heat on high to start boiling that down, and I'll get a pot of water to boil potatoes. I'm doing 3 russets. I'll peel them and then hack them into roughly equivalent chunks for faster and more even cooking. In those go to the water and get them boiling. This sauce took a half hour to reduce down. I didn't have to stir it or do anything until the end when you need to stir it constantly. It's full of sugar, and when it gets this thick, it could easily stick and burn on the bottom of the pan. When you can make little trails in it like that, you're done. Give it a taste and then make some adjustments. I'm going to throw in some balsamic vinegar or any vinegar just to brighten up the taste that's gone dull with the long cooking. And salt. This is a glaze. It should taste super intense because a tiny amount of it is going to flavor a large volume of meat. Speaking of which, here's the meat straight from the fridge. When it's cold like this, you can toss it around in the glaze pretty aggressively without breaking it up. Just cover it. If you don't have a lid, foil is fine. Leave the pan on just warm, and then the meat will heat through again. I'll drain off my potatoes, throw in a glug of milk and a big pinch of salt to start with, and yes, I'm going to put in the fat from the beef instead of butter. Mash that up, stir it, taste it, give it more salt or milk or anything else that you want, and now dinner is basically done. It could sit on the stove, on warm, just like this for hours without any degradation of quality, which is another reason this is great for dinner parties. You might have to add a little bit of water to the glaze if it starts to dry out, but that's all. I'm going to grab some fresh rosemary off my shrub, chop it up. I'll get some frozen peas thawing and some hot water in the microwave. I love peas in mash. Drain them off, throw in some butter and salt. I'll mix my rosemary into my potatoes right at the end to keep it green. Mash on the plate first, because out of our 3 elements here, that's the one that is best at retaining heat. Now, the beef is extremely delicate, so be very gentle as you lift it out and lay it on the plate. Pour a little glaze over each hunk, peas on the plate last because they go cold the fastest, and there you go. Candied beef butter really is the best way to describe this, which is why I think it's okay that we don't have a ton of meat per person here. It is extremely rich. And look at that, cooked to smithereens and yet still pink on the inside. Every strand of meat coated in melted fat and collagen. Gotta get myself a triple crown. That's mashed peas and saucy meat all on one forkful. To me, that is the stuff of dreams. And whatever your dreams are, a website from Squarespace can help you realize them. Think about it. A website is a place where you say to the whole world, here I am, here is what I can do, and come at me, bro. Whether you're a small business dreaming of customers, a nonprofit dreaming to help people, or a creator dreaming of having an audience, a website like this can help you start making those dreams happen. It's easy to build from one of Squarespace's templates. They host the site for you. They give you all the analytics you need to understand your traffic, the e-commerce tools to take people's money, everything you need. Dream big and then save 10% on your first site by going to squarespace.com/ragusea. Now let me get back to my dream. Hey, there's a thief.
A thief, Daddy.
Mm-hmm. Nice napkin.